Pleasure to present the first intimate panel of the Queering Partnering Conference. As you might already know, in this conference we are presenting the results of our first year of fieldwork that was conducted last year in Portugal, Spain and Italy. The title of the strand is the Micropolitics of Partnering. Focusing on the micropolitics of partnering, in this strand we investigated the daily management of intimate life of people who have chosen to be partnered in two under-researched forms of intimacy, lesbian coupledom and polyamory. Daily management of intimacy is referred to the decisions, needs and expectations of intimate partners with regards to making the relationships as well as to public recognition of such relationships. The results that we are presenting today regard the study on lesbian coupledom across time and space. The objective of the study was to gather empirical material to understand how lesbian women in Southern Europe choose to be partnered and to explore the impact of their choices on their everyday life. Therefore, the intimate team that was focusing on lesbian coupledom in each country interviewed key informants such as legal experts, activists, scholars, and so on, who helped us with the national context overview. Moreover, they conducted 5 qualitative interviews in each capital city, looking for self-defined lesbian, bisexual, queer, pansexual women, not necessarily cis women, aged between 25 and 45, who were in a lesbian relationship for at least 6 months, and who were not leader activists or spokesperson into the LGBTQ movement, but they could have been activists in other contexts. So I'm really excited to present my colleagues today and the research that they conducted last year. Anna Lucia Santos conducted the study in Lisbon, Luciana Moreira Silva conducted the study in Madrid, and Tatiana Motterle conducted the study in Rome. So as we did this morning, we will listen to the research team presentation first, and then we will open the debate. The first presentation is by Anna Lucia Santos. The title is Doing Conjugality, Lesbian Couples as Producers of Diverse Intimate Relationships.
Okay, so as Bea already told you, the main purpose of this study was to achieve a better understanding about the ways in which people experience their commitment to lesbian love relationships. And despite the relatively small sample of 5 biographic interviews, all of them were very heterogeneous between them, providing me a rich illustration of possible ways to maintain a love relationship and living in conjugality. With this presentation, I want precisely to show a little bit of these lives, of these intimate lives, focusing on the conjugal life. And I'm starting with the etymological origin of the word conjugal. So it derives from the Latin verb com, meaning together, plus iogare, meaning to join, and from the same word family, there is conjugo, that means to join or unite together, to put on an equality with. We can see that at the origin of this term, conjugality, usually associated with the institutional power of marriage, there are actually personal relations instead of institutional ones. So, so the etymology of conjugal leads us to a verb, And as such, I am proposing to think conjugality as a verb, as an action, an ongoing process with no universal or definitive configuration, as something constructed, unfinished, and diverse. In the traditional reading of conjugality, the couple is supposed to be a fixed entity based on a universal model, like two monogamous people, cohabitants in the same house, married with children, same race, same religion, etc. But we'll see that the lesbian conjugality, at least within my five interviews, does not rely on a universal model, but rather on a diversity of intimate arrangements. Now let me introduce you to my interviewees. Alex, 44 years old, is in a lesbian monogamic relationship for 25 years. She met her partner at school and they are girlfriends since then. They cohabit since the first years of dating, and Alex is trying to adopt children for 6 years by now. Dori is 35 years old. She's a Jewish woman in a lesbian monogamic relationship for 12 years. She and the partner met at a party, and the couple cohabit with Dori's biological son. Amy, 27 years old, is in a lesbian monogamic relationship for 7 years. She and her partner met at a LGBT association, and they are presently living apart together in different cities in Portugal. Raquel, 29 years old, is in a lesbian non-monogamic relationship for 1 year. She and her partner met, they got to know each other through a lesbian online network. They live in the same city, but they do not cohabit. Raquel's girlfriend is monogamous, and that induces a stress on Raquel for her to not get involved with other people, although she has a very peculiar way to get involved, not necessarily involving sexual connection, just for sex, getting attached by different modes of intimacy. And finally, Dora, 28 years old, is in a lesbian non-monogamic relationship for 7 months. She and the partner met through a smartphone application for meeting people. They cohabit in a kind of part-time mode, since Dora works for long periods outside Portugal, and for logistic reasons, it is benefit for both of them to share a house. Dora, she does not name her friend, girlfriend, her partner as girlfriend, but as accomplice instead. And her accomplice is not monogamous as well, and they both have sex with other people often. Okay, so we have three monogamous long-lasting relationships, but not all of them in cohabitation. One with a child, one trying to adopt, and another one living apart together, no children. The other two are non-monogamous people, one partially cohabiting, and the other not cohabiting at all. Raquel. Although these two are both non-monogamous, they have different ways of doing non-monogamy. One preferring the paradigm of one-night stands, and the other preferring a more lasting involvement with others. In each case, the partner is a central piece, assuming a hierarchical superior position in relation to others. Beside the fact that all of them have heterogeneous way of doing conjugality, they all have in common the fact that none is married, and their conjugal relation includes a set of practices that implies love, care, choice, negotiation, trust, complicity, relying on the centrality of the couple bound together, even if not physically together. And now I will give you some examples on that. When Alex and her partner decided to move in together to another city as soon as they could because of the homophobic context in their homeland and in the family of origin, they had to afford two houses in order to look like they live separately. This brought them an extra effort, economic effort, necessary in order to saving face. 6 years ago, they decided to adopt the child, but once they are waiting for so long by now, they decided to invest the money they had saved for the child, purchasing a vacation home instead. They both go back to their homeland, always together in the same car, yet Alex's mother refuses to talk about her private life, placing Alex's intimacy into a total invisibility. A lot of negotiation emerges from this lesbian relationship since the very beginning, in order to do things for the couple, and I would risk to say as a single entity. In a different way of negotiating conjugality, Amy and her girlfriend are now living apart together in different cities. But there was a moment in their lives when they got the chance to cohabit, and for Amy it was the most obvious decision ever. And I'll quote Amy. "It was nice to see how changes happened and how we dealt with it, because I am used to have my space. But when we move in with somebody else, everything changes. Everything we like to do alone no longer happens, or happens in a different way, or you kind of have to ask consent. So there was a moment she came to me and said, 'I want to play FIFA so bad.' And I said, 'I want to go to the computer so bad.' And we decided, 'You are going to play FIFA and I'm going to the PC. That moment when we both decided we wanted to do things that did not imply the other, we wanted to do our own stuff. And for some people, that's more problematic, but not for us." And she continues, "Okay, for a couple not used to cohabit, it's normal that it's not like that since the very beginning, as if we are super independent. Eventually, that independence inside our own home is gradually gained. And that happened in a very healthy way, I would say." It is interesting to see through a story the importance she gives to daily management in non-hierarchical basis, where dialogue and consensus take part, and to notice the way they do conjugality, first by giving up on themselves, on their particular hobbies, and then gradually reconquering their own space in the house, however, by not losing the connection and the good atmosphere. Currently, they are living in different cities because of their jobs, but they want to move in together one day and get married. When I asked why did they want to get married, she replied me that besides the fact that they want to be together, it will be an important moment for both to do the coming out for all of the family. According to Amy, it will be more real if she said she is lesbian by getting married to a girl than just to have a simple relationship with her, with the girl. I will return to this assumption later on the paper. Dori, the woman who cohabits with her partner and her son, she told me, "I guess I do not notice anymore that I'm a lesbian. For me, it's like I'm a normal person. I guess we think of ourselves as hetero. We have a routine. I'm going to wash the clothes. Okay, do it while I peel the potatoes. It's actually family life. There's not that glamour anymore of one saying, 'Oh, now I'm a lesbian. Uh-oh. Now I have to do a lot of modern things.'" For Dori, there's nothing in her private life that makes her think she's different than anyone else. Dori does not remember anymore she's a lesbian because she does not consider herself to be extraordinary. She's doing family in a very normative way, in her view. The fact that she thinks about herself as a normal person, that is, someone not outside the conjugal familial norm, meets what Jeffrey Weeks tells us about the fact that what makes stories extraordinary is having someone looking at those lives as such, defining them as different, inferior, and deviant. With the information provided so far, one could already argue that from these five stories, two of them are close to the ordinary way of doing conjugality. Monogamous people cohabiting with one child or trying to adopt. One almost ordinary, monogamous, living apart together, wanting to marry. And two absolutely extraordinary, non-monogamous, not cohabiting or partially cohabiting. No children. And let's have a closer look now at those extraordinary. The story of Raquel is permeated with care issues in her relationships. For instance, she cares about her homophobic mother. Parents, actually. She said, lies are a constant in here. Sometimes one gets tired, but then gives up and says, no, let's keep the peace. Parents deserve it. They're good people, so we make a sacrifice. Or the way she cares about her ex-girlfriends. My ex-girlfriend had a depression and it killed a lot of things. But do I stop loving her? Of course not. I feel the same thing. I feel all the butterflies. I feel all the things. I look at her and I see the same thing. I know that things are not going to work the way they are now, but that's part of the circumstances. And about the moment when she was negotiating the non-monogamy with a girlfriend and still caring about the ex-girlfriend, she said, it was not that I was going to say, look, I want a second girlfriend. But I said, look, I still have feelings for this person with whom I was with, and I care about her. And also about her girlfriends. She said, when I was in that open relationship, she was very shy. She had no self-confidence. So I tried to say, go meet people online, go talk to people, go do stuff for her to build some self-confidence, some confidence in herself, because I fully trusted her. I think that's important, even vital. So she knew I wasn't going to fall in love and run away with somebody else. I said, look, I like this person, I slept with a person, she's interesting and intelligent, I adore this person, but you know that for me, you come first, right? If the family of origin is usually associated with safety, this is not the case for most of lesbians in Portugal, as it is not for Raquel, neither for Alex. For instance, Alex, that woman with that 44 years old woman, she's living in a lesbian relationship for more than half of her life. Yet her mother refuses to talk about that. Raquel's mother is also very negative about homosexuality, but they try to talk about it unsuccessfully. In fact, those were very dramatic moments, and now Raquel prefers to hide her sexual orientation. So if she has the skills to negotiate her non-monogamy with her partners, the same does not happen in relation to her mother. We can see in Raquel's story that she has family responsibilities based on traditional lineage. Sorry. I didn't have the time to go to Google to see the pronunciation. Okay, so this responsibility when she decides to keep lying about her lesbian relationships. Hopefully, with her partners, there's responsibilities of other type. Even when not all of them agree with a non-monogamous relationship at first, they manage to reach an agreement. With her mother, it is different. There is no agreement or recognition. The author, Joan Tronto, situates herself against universal principles of care that by nature tend to neglect the web of relationships and their specificities. And in fact, Raquel's practices of care are contextualized. She does not care about strangers in the street. She does not care about work colleagues. In the public sphere, she is totally open about her sexuality. Although she cares about her mother and about her lovers in different terms. I borrow here the notion of transgressive caregiving from Lara Kessler to apply to Raquel because of her way of caring about her lovers and ex-lovers in specific non-normative responsible care that does not permit her to get attached even after the breakup, the breaking up. Okay. And she, Raquel, she also questions the societal rules of friendship and love relationships. And this is the last quote. What is socially accepted? How should I react? My way of being with people, even with close friends, is not what people consider a normal friendship. For me, to feel close to someone, sometimes I do sex with, because of the bonding, to connect with that person, so that person trusts you and tells you more things. If I'm going to tell something personal to someone, I have to be comfortable. And to be comfortable involves physical proximity, but not by physical reason, if that makes any sense. According to Sasha Rosenil, this will be one type of non-normative intimacies that does not fit the friend-lover binary classification system. However, in this case, I would say that this disruption does not center the significance of her conjugal relationship. Okay. However much the way of doing conjugality resembles the heteronormative model, social and sometimes legal recognition remains differentiated. Legal recognition does not guarantee rights in practical terms when power and choice come into play. I can have the power to choose to move in together, to get married, adopt a child, but sometimes what is seen as a normative decision is dependent on someone else's choice, who has the power to decide about my own choice, and who may prefer the heteronorm. And that's why Alex is waiting for so long, 6 years, for a child to adopt. I found a paradox between the diverse ways of doing conjugality and the moment people consider appropriate to come out to the family of origin. Data indicates that there is a general assumption about the best moment to come out. And that ideal time seems to coincide with the existence of conjugality. Even though each one of the interviewees has their own way of doing conjugality, most of them consider that it is a good decision to come out only when being in a situation of conjugality. And this mirrors the mainstream compulsory conjugality model in Portugal, according to which everything is done in order to benefit the normative couple, leading to a state where one's own sexuality does not exist by itself, but has to be legitimized by a marital status that produces standardized couples attached to rights and duties as stipulated in the Portuguese Civil Code. That's why it is important to rethink the possibilities of doing conjugality, decentered from the privileged norm, perhaps a nomadic conjugality, open to what the future may bring. That's it.
Thank you, Lou. The next presentation is about the case study conducted in Madrid. And Luciana Moreira will talk about lesbian coupledom between precarious lives and resistance against a normative system.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. I will read my text, so I won't get too messy. I don't have as much information as Lou on each interview, but at the end, if you want to ask anything about the same issues she addressed, be comfortable to do it, okay? So, the identities, geographies, and histories of sexual and gender dissidents were silenced for centuries as they hold the potential to undermine the patriarchal, heterosexist, colonialist, capitalist, and more recently neoliberal dominant frameworks. To a large extent, non-heterosexual people's lives are about silences, absences, violence, but also resistance, subversion, resilience. Even if some important changes are happening, drawing on human rights claims and legal achievements in various countries, people are still struggling often on a daily basis against invisibility, absence of recognition, and hostility. And now I need help. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm messed with this. In that sense, this long-term lack of recognition and hostility can be linked to Rob Nixon's concept of slow violence, and it's not there yet. Okay. For the author, understanding the concept of slow violence requires that we attempt to give symbolic shape and plot to formless threats whose fatal repercussions are dispersed across space and time. Nixon draws mostly on environmental problems that specially affect geographies of peoples whose lives are less grievable. The author also links the endurance of acts of slow violence with the fact that they do not have immediate repercussion on people's lives, there is no immediate drama involved, and no media visibility. Nixon concludes that collective agency is a fruitful form to resist and fight against environmental slow violence. Therefore, the concept of slow violence is deeply connected with debate about whose lives are more valuable or defendable. And it may be used to characterize peoples or geographies that are considered less important within a capitalist, neoliberal, neocolonial, patriarchal and heterosexist system that defends those who take privilege or are just accommodated to the system. In her essay, Can One Lead a Good Life in a Bad Life? And again, Judith Butler poses the question, whose lives matter? Hence underlying the biopolitics around life's importance. The issue can be extended to the question if the very loss of life is worthy of mourning or grievable as she conceptualizes it. Subsequently, according to Butler, the future of one's life, and I quote, depends upon that condition of support, so if I am not supported, then my life is established as tenuous, precarious, and in that sense, not worthy to be protected from injury or loss, and so not grievable. End of quote. Similar to Nixon, Butler understands the power of interdependency and the performativity that emerges from, and I quote, when a social movement calls for a new way of life, a form of livable life, then it must, at the moment, enact the very principles it seeks to realize. Therefore, considering the undeniable presence of normativity and homonationalism in Western actual societies, especially among gay men, it is necessary to understand other intersectional categories, such as social context, class, ethnicity, age, disability, that approximate or withdraw people from homonormative or homonationalist ideologies or practices. In that regard, I am arguing here that both concepts, slow violence and precarious lives, can be applied to the lives of sexual and gender dissident people. However, it is necessary to have into account that this dissidence is a matter of how sexual and gender dissidents' existence, identities and lives trigger on others, a matter of how these lives get to be interpreted and represented by others, and therefore to what extent their lives become precarious and likely to suffer from slow violence. As argued by Ana Cristina Santos, discrimination is a collective product that stems from unequal power relations instead of an individual problem. Therefore, the focus is moved away from the individual victim to the structural system that enables and legitimizes discrimination. Santos proposes the concept of queer public sociology for scholars who address queer theory and queer or LGBT activism on their scholar work. I depart from Santos' principle on the need to echo the voices and demands that arise from social movements and collective action, approaching slow violence against self-perceived lesbians and pansexual women in lesbian relationships, drawing on the interviews I carried out in Madrid last year. My interviewees perceived many hostile attitudes both within families of origin and in public spaces, with the former being most significant. Slow violence coming from the state is another form of it that I will not have the time to address in this presentation. One of the examples of slow violence within families of origin is provided by Elisa's narrative. She's an early 30 pansexual woman who started dating women at the age of 18 when she went to Madrid to study. The very first year there, she started a relationship with an elder woman. Her cousin, with whom she was living, tried to persuade her to break up the relationship, and as Elisa did not do so, she kicked her out of the house and told Elisa's parents about their early relationship. From that moment on, Elisa lived very difficult moments of slow violence, and she relates, "I remember a trip to London that I made with my parents. We were drinking something, and then my father shot the bullet. 'You have made me suffer a lot,' and I asked, 'But why?' He said, 'You have made me suffer a lot. I've cried more because of you than for my parents' death.' To me, it was like overturning inside a car. I thought, 'You're saying it, but you are not even thinking,' because it is a sentence with a strong connotation. I have always tried to put myself in their shoes, to think where they came from, the education they had, and I can even understand their first reaction. But then you cannot go on with the same speech. You have to accept me, and if you really love me and want to share my life and the things that happened to me, you cannot keep saying these things." Until the moment of the interview, Elisa's parents were not aware of the damage caused by their long-term hostile attitudes and how that may affect her relationship with her girlfriend, Rocío. They are together for 4 years and sharing an apartment and a dog, remember this morning? For 3 years, and yet every time they go to visit Elisa's parents, they have to face difficult situations like this one. Now every time I go to my village, Rocío goes with me and the dog. Of course, there are things that still make them uncomfortable. If we met someone we know, my mother always says, "This is Elisa's roommate." She's afraid of telling the truth. And in the end, she forces me to remain hidden, even if I don't want to. Another example comes from Irene's story. Irene is a mid-40s trans woman. She's an actress, and she defines herself as lesbian. She interrupted her relationship with her mother because she could not bear her mother's hostility every time they spoke to each other or spent time together. One of the situations she told me about is the following. My second sister has two children, and I love her little daughter. She looks a lot like me. She had them with a man who turned out to be a nice guy, in fact, a great guy, and one day they decided to marry. It was the opposite, it's nice. It was after I started the hormonal treatment. My mother managed things so that I couldn't go to the wedding. It is also my responsibility. I didn't have enough strength, but it was also the context in which I just wasn't strong enough at the time. Irene knows that she did not go to her sister's wedding because of her mother. They were already having a difficult relation since she told her that she was determined to embrace her gender identity. Irene's mother revealed a paternalist attitude of allegedly knowing better what is best for her daughter, and moreover, Irene does not even mention her sister's opinion or any kind of positive attitude from her, which may be understood as a passive acceptance of transphobia within the family. Even worse, she considered herself as being jointly responsible for what happened. Regarding slow violence in public spaces, Amaya's interview provides interesting insights. Amaya is in her early 20s. She's a sign language interpreter and she lives with her girlfriend and two friends. She told me about a lesbophobic insult she heard in the neighborhood that relates to slow violence and a sense of tremendous precariousness when it happens. I always go to the same greengrocers, that is, they know me there. And once I was getting apples when an older gentleman was going down the street and shouted at me, "You, you're a slut, what the hell are you doing?" And I was like, "Let's see, what happened? And he goes on, "What the hell are you doing without wearing a glove?" And I answer, "I don't know." I looked and saw that there were 6 people in the fruit store and no one was wearing gloves. Yes, there are gloves and you have to catch them, but it seems a bit disproportionate to me. And I said to him, "If you want me to wear a glove, just tell me, but don't yell at me." And he says, "Because it's you. After playing with your cousin's pussy, you are touching the fruit." Unfortunately, and according to her, it's their visibility as a couple that lead to this kind of situation, even if we're talking about a city as Madrid. Prejudice is there, and to live openly as a lesbian couple is still associated with something dirty in a conservative society and still put those women in risk of violence, physical or psychologically. Nevertheless, my interviews managed to overcome the precariousness of their lives and the slow violence perpetrated on them by both collective action and activism, friendship networks and intimate relationships in order to somehow value themselves and their daily experiences and live a good life, as in Butler's question. However, they report situations in which it becomes apparent that they have lived difficult moments through their trajectories and have the feeling that they do not fit in the world they are living in. They have left or are trying to leave what may be seen as a zone of silences and of the untold, looking forward to find different communities where they can have a deeper sense of belonging. To illustrate that, I will use the example of Yasmin, a Belgian lesbian young woman in her late 20s who is now living in Madrid. There she could finally look for things she likes or cares about, and she found people, women mostly, with the same interests, and it happened that half of them were lesbians. After a difficult adolescence and early youth in the Straitsland, and this is how she put it to me, going to Madrid was a turning point in her life and a ticket to Dykesland, Bolleroland in Spanish as she used it. She engages in a feminist women percussion jam session group who acts in both leisure places and activist manifestations, and this is how she draws on it. In fact, in the women percussion jam sessions group, we have a hairdresser who cuts the hair of almost everyone, of all dykes, and she does lesbian haircuts. She does it great, actually. And it's funny because this hairdresser is straight and she also cuts the hair of the straight girls there. And then they seem more lesbian than me. And it's great! Because at the end, I'm talking about lesbians, but for example, within the feminist gym, there are heterosexuals, there are bisexuals. Then we talk about lesbians. I say lesbian, but it is no longer a lesbian as a woman who sleeps with women. In fact, I mean lesbians as a collective. Then it includes straights. Also, Sasha Rosenil highlights the importance of queering care and friendship and the importance of friendship as a form of legal and social resistance to normative obligations that are most of the times more a burden than a matter of choice and self-determination, which could also be lead to the mentioned slow violence experiencing among families of our origin. Among my interviewees, I heard almost unbearable stories of hostility and suffering, but I also heard about moments of happiness linked to love, friendship and activism. Most of the interviewees were activists in queer feminist groups or anti-austerity movements in Spain. An explanatory factor is linked to the context of austerity and economic precariousness in which the majority of respondents live, sometimes depending on their partners, but still remaining free from hierarchies within the couple. In almost all cases, both the way they are doing conjugality, as proposed by Ana Lúcia, and collective action they are involved in are about refusing the patriarchal, heterosexist and neoliberal Western system based on care and interdependency among partners, ex-lovers, ex-partners, friends and communities in general. It is undeniable, of course, that some gays and lesbians are accommodated to an hegemonic system embracing homonormativity and the neoliberal regime, and assuming that the Western societies in general and some countries or cities in particular, like Madrid with Gay Pride and Troika, are the super developed region of the globe where homophobia is almost inexistent. Nevertheless, it may be argued that the violence that sexual and gender dissidents are subject to is also a product of the same societies, Western societies. Therefore, the gender binary system and heteronormativity are constructs that legitimize patriarchal and capitalist societies, so sexism, homophobia and transphobia are prejudices and forms of discrimination that, apart from cases of tremendous physical violence, have been practiced in forms more in forms of slow violence. In Madrid, those women's lives, their relationships, their friendships, networks, their social and political engagement, don't show me the time, put this system into question, challenging the norm through the way they are living, they live conjugality, friendship, and their political and social action. Political change is a reality, but among my interviews, people were being supported and carried by their chosen networks much more than by the state or traditional families of origin. As Gracia Trujillo said, finishing her book and claiming the role of social movements regarding mostly legal transformations already achieved in Spain, they never gave us nothing, why would they give us now?
Thank you, Luciana, for managing the time so well as well. And now it's Tatiana's turn, and she will be presenting the case study in Rome, and the title of her presentation is Lesbian Couples in Rome, Queering Family Meals.
So good afternoon again, everybody. Thanks for being still here. I will start by talking very briefly about the Italian legal situation. Since it is very different from Spain and Portugal's, Italy rates very poorly compared to other European countries regarding LGBT rights. As you can see on this map, this ILGA map, which shows the national legal and policy human rights situation of LGBTI people in Europe. In Italy, we only have one law on rectification of sex attribution and one against discrimination, also based on sexual orientation in the workplace. This year, in February, Cirinna Bill on civil unions was approved by one of the chambers of the parliament and is waiting for the other chamber final approval. After months of parliamentary debate with a strong opposition by right-wing, conservative and Catholic politicians, you can see the Vatican here, and by the Catholic Church itself, the provision on stepchild adoption was eliminated from the already very basic text of the bill, thus leaving the status of hundreds of LGBT parents who were waiting for recognition still unchanged. As regards my participants, very briefly, I interviewed three self-defined lesbian and two self-defined bisexual cis women. All of them were white, able and born in Italy, but not all of them in Rome. Actually, the majority came from other cities or regions of Italy. As you can see, the sample is rather varied regarding age, job and living arrangements. The participants cover almost all age ranges between 25 and 45. One is a student at the university, two are unemployed, they were when I interviewed them. They are supported by their partner or family of origin. One is a freelancer and another one is an employee. Living arrangements are also varied, from living apart together and long distance relationships to living together as a couple or with other people. Many interesting issues emerged from my interviews, but today I will only talk about two of them in particular. Coming out and visibility within families of origin is one, and the other is ideas and practices regarding the couple. Starting with coming out to family of origin, we will see on the one hand the importance that the relationship with the families have for the participants, and on the other hand, the invisibility strategies they deploy with their families. The relationship with families of origin is deemed very important by most of the interviewees. For example, Lenu says, you care about your family, it's almost instinctive, isn't it? Unfortunately, family approval is really the first one. Victoria says, the people who should understand you better actually belong to your family. You know that if you tell them about your lesbianism, you could break something, but if you don't, something inside you breaks, because you're not free to be who you really are. Indeed, all the women who explicitly talked about their coming out recalled when they came out to their parents. Usually, this regards a nuclear family, that is, parents and siblings, sometimes one parent in particular, but extended family was also mentioned. All of them, as you can see, all of them came out after starting a relationship, as Anna Lucia also found. Ipazia, for example, says, I was really excited when I started my relationship with Andra, so excited that I immediately told my mother. Victoria says, I had been dating this person for some months, so I decided to tell my family and tell my friends. Moreover, independently from parents' reaction, the will of the participants is to keep the relationship with them going and to demand recognition and acceptance, both for themselves and for the couple. Most of the experiences of daily strategic invisibility and visibility narrated by the participants involved their family of origin and their partners. Indeed, the couple stood out as an element of visibility, as the proof of lesbianism or bisexuality from which the family cannot look away. On the other hand, it is also a factor of banalization of the relation, as Natasha Cecuti says, that is, the couple per se can render lesbianism visible without the necessity of declaring it directly. Moreover, the normative value represented by the couple can be a means to render lesbianism or bisexuality more acceptable. The experiences of two interviewees in particular, Ipazia and Lenu, show the complex and multifaceted functioning of strategic invisibility and visibility, and the continuous process of coming out, intertwined with the visibility of the couple. You will see how these two cases are very similar. Both Ipazia and Lenu came out to one parent only first. Both come from another region, and when they visit their parents, usually during holidays, they take or would like to take their partner with them. And then the symbolic importance of family meals emerges here. Lenu came out to her father first, since they have a very good relationship. Her mother discovered by reading her diaries that she was in love with a girl, and she reacted very badly. So Lenu tried to confront her and to convince her that there was nothing wrong in being a lesbian. She is bisexual, actually, but fights with her mother are always about her being a lesbian. Having failed to convince her mother, Lenu eventually gave up and went back to the closet. Avoid talking to her mother about relationships with women. She says, I told her, this is a prejudice. Well, sometimes you need to have prejudice, her mother answers. I was shocked, and from then on, I tried to let my mother know fewer and fewer things because I didn't want to be myself the victim of her prejudices. During this period of closet, Lenu even visited her parents together with her partner, but differently from Ipazia's experience, as you will see, both Lenu and her mother performed the closet, both pretending that the partner was just a friend. After 2 years of relationship with Noe, her present partner, Lenu tried again and told her mother about her, describing Noé as a good and calm person, graduated with honors. "Those things my mother likes," she says. So she tried to use the normal couple strategy, but it didn't work anyway, and her mother kept having problems with her lesbian relationship and refusing to meet Noé. Then Lenu decided to adopt a more aggressive strategy, and the couple had become a means of in-your-face visibility, both in the public space and in the private one. In the public space, because Lenu recently had to stay in a hospital for a while, and during visiting hours, the couple displayed affection even in front of the shocked mother. In the private space, because Lenu pushed her mother to invite her and Noé for dinner during summer holidays. During this whole process, Lenu somewhat tried to take care of her mother, as Lou also found. I mean, she cared about her feelings, her fears, and also her prejudice. And she's still doing it in some way, but at the same time, as she says, she doesn't want to give up her happiness. I told my mother, "I surely cannot give up my happiness for yours." Hypatia came out to her mother as soon as she started her first lesbian relationship, as we already see. She wasn't interested in being out with her father, since she didn't get along very well with him. Anyway, on the fourth year of Hypatia's relationship with her present partner, Anna, her father started asking her about Anna and eventually invited the couple for dinner. Hypatia and her father never talked explicitly about her bisexuality, nor about her relationship with Anna. The couple functioned in that occasion as a means of silent visibility, of banalization of the revelation. Indeed, the presence of her partner at dinner in her father's house is deemed enough a declaration by Hypatia. She says, "Let's say that was precisely the entrance. Without talking about it, I take my partner to your home, not as a friend, as a partner." We will see, maybe have time about it, but Hypatia also, there's also a difference between the visibility in public and in the family, as you find out, maybe we will talk about it later. Going on with the second topic, ideals and practices regarding the couple. These interviewees surely share a romantic and mononormative ideal of the couple. Adult relationships, the idea of adult relationships and the teleological narrative are two examples of this ideal. But some nuances also emerged, in particular as regards their practices. The adult relationship, the ideal and good one, is commonly described as monogamous, even when practices are non-monogamous. For example, Alice practiced consensual and non-consensual non-monogamy in the past. She defined respectively consensual and non-consensual non-monogamy as non-exclusive couple and cheating. But she seems now to value her present absolutely exclusive relationship as the good one. She reinterprets her non-monogamous past as a failure in terms of intimate relationships. In her account, she said she shed a devaluing light on her past experiences, depicting them and herself as immature in opposition to the adult relationships she is presently in. Non-monogamy is then depicted as a representation of that immature past instead of an acceptable alternative to the exclusivity of the couple. Harris also assumes, as you can see, the narrative of cheating as a demonstration of the lack of real love, then devaluing her previous relationships as less serious and important compared to the present one. She says, "Ours is a full-fledged marriage." She also underlines the fact that they are normal as any other couple. And she also says, "Olivia is the only person I never cheated on. She is the adult relationship of my life. It's an absolutely exclusive relationship." Hypatia has been regularly cheating on her present partner and doesn't interpret that as problematic. Indeed, she describes herself as a cheater. She says, "Yes, I've been cheating on Anna several times. I almost had a relationship with a girl too, but I never put into discussion my relationship with her. She then reproduces a monogamous couple pattern in which exceptions to monogamy need to remain secret in order to preserve the relationship. Thus, also in this case, non-monogamy is actually practiced, but it never led Hypatia to put into discussion the structure of the monogamous couple and to think about consensual non-monogamy. Then, the ideal of the adult relationship conveniently describes a sort of teleological narrative that also came up in some interviews. A narrative which envisions previous relationship as learning experiences and the present one as the last one, or at least the most durable and serious and strong up to now. Even when the present relationship is in a crisis, the teleological narrative persists in the guise of the wait for the right person. Hypatia says, so far, I haven't found the person yet, the person with capital P. Nonetheless, if it is true that such narrative implies a romantic and normative vision of love and the couple, on the other hand, it also entails a self-empowering and self-determining vision, not only of one's way to live and build relationships, but also of personal growth as an individual, a positive trajectory leading to the avoidance of painful and destructive relationships, a path along which these women learn to respect themselves and their own desires, to not give up to their personal well-being, to demand being cared of instead of only taking care of. Moreover, there is not only the couple. Lenoux explicitly talked about family of choice, which she called familia acquisita in-laws, and they are her family in Rome. And she says, I have a family there, meaning in her original, in her region where she was born. And I also have a family here in Rome. It doesn't necessarily have to be just about Noe. It can be about my friends, the people I feel good with. And here they come again, family meals. In this case, family of choice meals. Lenoux says, talking about family life and family moments, she says they mainly have to do with lunches and dinners, the familial situation par excellence. So we were in the kitchen eating, and Maria said, you look like a family a la Ospetek. You actually look like the people of Saturn in opposition. This thing made me proud. It means that the people I love, with whom I live, they are my life. It means that we were able to convey this. She's talking about Ferdinand Ospetek, which is a Turkish movie director living and working in Italy. Most of his movies include the stories of groups of LGBTQ and straight friends, perfectly representative of the ideal of family of choice. The representation of the typical Italian picture of meals together is a recurring scene in these movies, and this picture comes from the movie Saturno contro Saturno in opposition, Lenoux is talking about. In the other interviews, the issue of friendships emerged more occasionally and briefly, probably due to the fact that the interview was explicitly about coupledom, but this didn't happen, for example, for Luciana. Friendship and friends are surely deemed important, though. However, it seems that the couple keeps occupying the central role in these women's emotional lives. Using Sasha Rosny's words, it is true that the interviewees identified their friends, or a combination of friends, partner, children, and family, as the most important people in their lives. On the other hand, differently from what Rosny found, it seems to me that the couple keeps functioning here as the primary space of intimacy. Concluding, the couple surely occupies a central place in the emotional life of the participants, and it is seen through the lens of romantic ideas. But practices and experiences seem much more nuanced. Nonetheless, even when the difference between ideas and practice is clear, it does not seem to prompt substantial critical reflections nor actual changes. The romantic narrative of the ideal couple keeps guiding participants' attitudes towards intimate relationships. We have to consider that, as we know, not only the narrative of romantic love is extremely strong in general, but that it also has been extensively employed by mainstream LGBT politics. Here are a wonderful example of homo-nationalism. Moreover, women in particular are still strongly socialized to believe on the absolute centrality of love and the couple in their lives. Lesbian or bisexual identity and visibility are deemed important by the participants. Their importance is described as a question of personal well-being and authenticity, and is strongly connected to the couple and to the relationship with the family of origin. Participants expect from their family that they approve and embrace their lesbianism or bisexuality. The effort deployed by some of them in order to preserve the relationship with the family without renouncing the visibility of the couple confirms what Chiara Bertone recalls when she describes personal communities in Italy as developed less outside than inside the family. Moreover, as Bertone and Maria Pallotta Chiaroli argue in their book Queering Families of Origin, there is still little research about families of origin, in particular in Southern Europe, where, as they say, I quote, intergenerational closeness and dependence mark people's lives. Results from this interview show that this issue is central, indeed, and that contextualized research studies are still needed, not only to understand how families of origin are involved, but also to analyze the interactions between families of origin and families of choice. Thank you.